It's the MythWits, a geek pop culture web series, broadcast live for video and audio podcasts. Watch us live at MythWits.com and find us on YouTube and iTunes, bringing you news and reviews about geek pop culture. We have comedy skits, play nerdtastic games, and provide extensive on-location con coverage. And now, your hosts.
Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to the MythWits. I'm your host, Peter Bryant, and before we go any further, this show is not safe for work. Let me introduce to you my guest host this evening. As always, the Trixie Game Master, Mike Kafis.
I hate you, Pete.
Okay.
You gave me plague.
I don't know
how your dirty mix came through the internet and just infected my nostrils and my nosticles and everything else, but I am like in shitville. I'm all hopped up. Is this show safe for being all hopped up on NyQuil, DayQuil, and any other Benadryls and
Peter Jason Quill,
Eds, Feds, and Leds?
And butt flutes? Yes, it is safe for all of that.
I didn't say nothing about no butt flute.
And part of my coughing, folks, I has plague as well. And the man with the golden voice, our news anchor, Brian Olvera.
Greetings.
Joining us tonight, and what's interesting is that this man joins me about every other week on another podcast. Hal Reiher, John Reiher. Welcome to the MythWits, Mr. Reiher.
Hey, thank you.
Welcome to the MythWits.
Yep.
So actually, it's been too long, John. I was telling John today, I was like, I feel guilty. I haven't invited him on the show in over a year.
Speaking of butt flutes, it's been too long, right?
Right. Yes. This one time at band camp. So I invited John to come on because he works with a company called Tri Tac Games. He's one of the designers and writers. Mm-hmm. And John and I have been doing a podcast for Tri Tac Games for about, what is it? What's up?
Hold on. 225 episodes now.
Man, we are lagging something fierce. Hold on 1 second. Let it rest for just a second. Everybody just calm down. Okay. All right. So how long has it been, John?
Oh, well, I'm going to the site. How far does it go back? Scroll. October 2009.
Oh, my God.
It was when we started. Yeah, we've been doing this for a while. Like I said, we're up around 258 right now.
Right. Podcast so, long time.
Yeah. Yeah, Corey. That's official episodes. We actually have half a Number of the Beast episodes right now.
Half. Oh wow, that many, really? Wow. Yeah. Holy shit. Hold on 1 second, folks. Give me 1 second. I got to slip off a camera for a second. I left the door open, and my family's gonna yell at me. Hold on 1 second.
Peter, close the door.
Right. They're not yelling at me just yet. So Tri Tac Games. So John, how did you wind up getting involved in Tri Tac Games? Oh, actually, let's start. What is Tri Tac Games in a nutshell?
Oh, it's one of the original garage game companies that started back in the 70s, actually under the name Tacky Tac Games, and it was a combination of Richard Tohoka, Richard Sadler, and Doc. I forgot his last name. Sorry, Doc. and they first went and created the Morrow Project. Yeah. And then due to various political things they went on, then they went out and formed Tacky Tac Games. And that was with Richard by himself, more or less. And Tacky Tac Games was basically a lot of little pocket games. They weren't board games, but they weren't role-playing games. They were this hybrid thing he created. Some were really fun, like the Monster Squash, which were designed to work with clay.
Right.
And but also around that time, Richard started a playtest of a science fiction game that later went on to become his science fiction role playing game, FTL 2448. I was in the original playtest for that game.
Right.
I was a playtester for Mara Project. And I took several sessions before I didn't die.
So what is FTL?
Oh, FTL? Faster Than Light.
Okay.
Yeah. FTL 2448, set in the year 2448. It's its own little setting. These days, it's very much space opera. It was hard science fiction, but these days, it's sort of slid into space opera.
Right. You
know, it happens.
Yeah, because his newer iterations, he's doing some interesting stuff with it, right? Like, isn't he doing some stuff like a ship is from the 50s, or is that a different game?
That's a different game. He's actually, there's a thing called Easy Space, which is basically, you know, God and Heinlein was right, and we build rocket ships.
Okay.
You know, back in the 50s, and, you know, atomic rocket ships and crap. You know, basically it's rocket punk. There's Easy Space. Then there's, the game he's most famous for is Bureau 13. That one got stolen at least by at least two or three TV shows.
By
name.
Let's do that real quick. So we've got, yes. All right, hold on. So Richard has invented three genres of TV shows.
Before. Well, no, hold on.
Science fiction, about
Fringeworthy yet.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, Fringeworthy. Yeah, we'll get there. Fringeworthy was actually the last, I don't want to say it was first developed, but it was like second developed. It was like the last one to get released.
Okay. You've got Bureau 13, which was pretty much the precursor for shows like Buffy and all of these Monster Hunters.
It came out around the exact same time Ghostbusters came out.
Okay.
And no, we didn't steal it from Ghostbusters. It was already in production before then.
So then you've got Incursion. Which
that's a layer game, yeah.
Was it Incursion?
That's a layer game. It's basically the game's released. First thing it was released was Bureau 13.
Mm-hmm.
Then FTL was released more or less the same time, and then Fringeworthy, all within the period of like 3 years in the early 80s.
Well, what I was getting at was that the games that were weren't purposely hijacked. I mean, we don't know. I'm just saying, but these were original ideas of Richard's prior to becoming popular culture. What's the one that's like Farscape?
Well, Farscape. That's Incursion.
That's Incursion, right?
But Incursion. Yeah, but Incursion came out. Well, it was in development way before it happened. But unfortunately, like a lot of his games, sat in the shelf for a while.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, it was like Farscape. Like nothing out there.
Oh, Hard Wired Hinterland.
It's one of those weird games. Though I have found out, yes, it's one of the weird games. As is, come on, brain. Weird Zone, which also came out. Interesting enough, based on talking to Richard, I realized that Bureau 13, Incursion, Hardware Hinterland, and are more or less in the same unit. Hardware Hinterland? No, scratch that. Incursion and Bureau 13. Well, Incursion 1, Incursion 2. There's actually two Incursion products. Are all in the same universe.
Mm-hmm.
Hardware Hinterland, Weird Zone, and Fringeworthy are all in the same universe as well.
Okay.
But we'll find out as he produces more information.
Right.
And FTL is its own thing. Right. So so that doesn't cross over with anything else. So
all right, so he came out with FTL, and that was a space game. It's his far future game. It's his Wars, Star Trek-ish era game.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then you said his more popular game that he came out with next was Bureau 13. Right.
Yes, Bureau 13. Yes, because it's basically the easiest one to approach. It's basically your secret agents fighting supernaturally in the United States, and that's the elevator pitch. And there's at least how many different TV shows were created based on that concept?
Yeah, a zillion. It's a good concept.
Yeah. Or variations of the theme, like what was the one in Britain with the dinosaurs?
Torch. Primeval.
Primeval, yeah. Primeval is a variation of that.
I was going to say Dinotopia.
Oh, wait. Wait a minute. Yes. Hi, Allegra.
I was waiting for a break to welcome Allegra to on board. But yes, Allegra, have you heard of any of these games that we're talking about so far? Allegra is a gamer.
She's a total gamer. But these games are, Allegra, these are the best games you've never played.
Oh.
They're the best games you've never heard of.
Got to add it to my list then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, there's and of course there's some of these mini. It's in the mini games got kind of infamous, like Polly Wumpus, where you're playing Cub Scouts near Three Mile Island, and a giant mutant duck attacks you, and all you have is what's in your pockets.
Oh, God. Hey, wait a minute! Didn't he have Beach Bunny Bimbos? That was one of
Beach Bunny Bimbos with blaster. But I'll be honest, I think he did that one in response to. BTRC's version.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Oh, crap. What was it? Girls with guns. Something with... oh, shit.
Yes. Anyway. You're, I can't remember.
Right.
They released that one.
But... It was a Hot Girls with Guns book.
Yeah. Yeah, and he in this case, he decided leverage... the incredibly bad, TV series War of the Worlds.
Okay.
So they're Martians,
right?
So the Beach Bunny Bimbos are fighting off Martians. They're basically they're Buffies.
So it's
Beach Bunny Bimbos are Buffies basically.
So it's like Buffy meets Mars Attacks.
Yeah.
Okay.
Put that on the back of the box.
So my favorite is Fringeworthy. That's always been my favorite because it's an interdimensional game.
Me too. Mm-hmm. Me too.
Yeah, Mike too. It's essentially for folks because I guarantee you none of you guys have heard of Fringeworthy. If anybody's heard of Fringeworthy, I'd be really surprised. But Fringeworthy is pretty much,
Stargate.
Stargate. Yeah, Richard hates this reference, but it's pretty much a lot like Stargate meets Sliders. So imagine you go through the ring like the Stargate people do, but you don't go to other worlds like in the same universe. Mm-hmm. You go to other universes. And basically, it's something where you can take one character and adventure anywhere. So if the game master says, well, I have a D&D module I'd like to run, right? You can play that with your characters. You can roll right in with the machine guns and go crazy. And then... The next night, once you finish that adventure, the next adventure you go on, he might say, I have this old Boot Hill module. I'm going to run that. Same characters, same adventure, same storyline. You can go to it. It's pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And John, Fringeworthy's under some... something's happening with that, right?
Well, both Beer 13... Excuse me. Both Bureau 13 and Fringeworthy had D20 version made. Actually, it's called OGL, which is where it really was.
Right.
An OGL version made. One thing we did there was to give it more background. So we did a lot more fleshing out because Richard likes to keep things close to the vest.
Yes.
But lately he's been dumping that. He's been opening the vest up and flashing everything he has underneath it right now.
I think he's getting on in age and he realizes that if he doesn't release this shit now, it's never going to get released. Those secrets will die with him.
Yeah, but I started work on, and I sort of regret working on it sometimes. But on a Savage Worlds edition of Fringeworthy,
right?
That one's been my consuming passion for 4 years now.
Right, right. So where are we on that now?
Because
I was working with you on that.
200 pages far in a Word doc. That'll probably translate once it's laid out maybe into 150 pages.
Okay.
If we get graphics. But it's not done yet because, the rules are done.
Right.
Anything that deals with rules, those are done. That was the easy part. The hard part is all the fluff text.
Okay.
All the background, all the stuff, and also some adventures. At least I decided not to do adventures because every time I send them out, people would find them broken.
Mm-hmm.
Every time. So instead, I'm giving people sandboxes.
Okay.
Here's a world. Here's a setting. Here's some ideas you can use.
Here's some key players. Here's some seeds. Here's some
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so how close, I mean,
and
like,
I think that...
Like, are we talking this year? This year? I'm trying to be vague, you know. Are you talking, could it conceivably be done this year?
I win the lottery, I can then spend time doing nothing but it. You know, my biggest problem is that I'm a technical writer in my day job. So I write all day, and then the last thing I want to do sometimes is sit down and write some more at the computer. You know, that's the hard bit. But no, I mean, I've gotten through 200 pages. I mean, it takes a while because a lot of times I had to rewrite things. I've thrown stuff out.
Okay.
I mean, there was I was going to make a custom psionic section. Then I realized it was way too freaking complex.
All right, just make a power.
So I just dumped it. Yeah. No. It was still using the power system, but I was creating this skill tree.
Ah, I see. Okay.
And the skill tree was starting to get complex.
Right. Yeah, you don't want to make it too difficult. All right, so that's in the works. And what about Bureau 13?
Yeah, right now, after talking to Richard, it's more likely if we do another Bureau 13 thing, it'll be a systemless book.
Okay, so currently Bureau 13 is D20, right?
An original flavor,
right. And then the next version that you guys might do, because I know, wasn't Trav working on something for it? Some kind of steampunk version of it?
I think he was working with Richard on there was the steam, Brass and Steel, but that's actually been released.
Okay.
Brass and Steel got released. But he's also working with Richard on the Coptics, which is a watered down Gaoub.
right. For Fringeworthy, for the Fringeworthy games.
For some Fringeworthy, villains. Yeah. Yeah, basically they're basically Caesar and Cleopatra form an empire. And the Coptics are is the offspring of this empire they created.
Right. So
that's gonna be released.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
It's amazing. He's releasing all this stuff through the portal books.
Okay.
Which we find convinced them don't actually give them actual portal numbers. Just here they are. Let the GM decide where he's going to stick it.
Okay. Oh, God. In his universe. Stick it in your universe right here.
I want to say something about that real quick because one of the things, I mean, our group has always done is. Fringeworthy has been like a wrapper. It's wrapped. It's always been able. We've always used the rules, the basic core rules of the fringe paths, but we've always wrapped it around any, and we've converted anything we needed to any other system. And I think that was, I mean, I'm not saying that anything is being done wrong or right or anything, because I'm not, you know, any kind of a expert on that. But I just know that I think that if anyone who uses it. Is a big fan of Fringeworthy. Anyone we've ever talked to, Pete, has said that. You know, it's sort of a wraparound.
Yeah, it's a setting. It's more of a setting than a system. You know, and to make it a system, I think it kind of takes away from it. I think keep it as a setting. But you know, you kind of do have to have some setting rules for some things. Sure. You know, like if you're gonna.
Yeah, but I said. Yeah. And I got 4 years into the project.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. My new mantra is the perfect is the enemy of done.
Yes. Yes. It is. Yes. It is. So let me get some of my co-hosts involved here. So we got let's go with Allegra. You're a big gamer. So what do you think about that? What do you think about playing a game where you can go? All right. So let's set it up. So you're on this. You're on Earth, what they call Earth Prime. So you're on regular Earth. There's a what they call a portal station. It's in Antarctica. They found the portal there, much like in Stargate. They found the ring, and then they moved it to the Colorado base. So then you start going through this portal, and
here they didn't move it. It's still stuck in Antarctica.
Yeah, but here it's still stuck, right? So you go through these. You go through the portal, and as you go through the portal, you go out onto this what they call a platform. And it's like this big floating disc in space. And basically, these rings are on a big, it's like platforms with rings and pathways.
600 foot platform that has smaller 25 foot gates on it. That's the prime platform.
Well, I'm
and
trying
then
to
one
just,
big 50,
I'm just trying to paint over this in a big, easy picture. So you've got all these rings and pathways and portals and stuff like that, and it's all mapped out. So in other words, you don't like dial the portal and then go to a world. You step through it and you go wherever it goes. And every time you go through a certain portal, it goes to that world. So it's kind of like if you imagine
Gateway.
Yeah, they were gateways.
Paul's like
If you were no, walking,
no, like Paul's Gate, Hichi Rendezvous. I read the novel. Basically, they have all these pre-programmed ships that take you someplace through a wormhole system.
Yeah,
you don't know where you're going.
Well, John, I was going to equate it to imagine if you were like walking through like a forest, and every tree in the forest had a portal built into it, and that tree always goes to that world. It's kind of like that.
That's a good Christmas way to put it. Christmas land, Halloween land.
Right, exactly. Yeah. No, that's perfect. That's perfect. Just like that. Okay. Except it's in space. It's floating in space. So you could play the same characters, but you could go to all these different worlds, and they can be any alternate the DM makes up. So he can pick any movie, any book, any game, anything he wants, and you can go there, and you're always playing the same characters. I love it. I think it's awesome.
And so like there's like just consistent like combat rules and like what how everything works that kind of unifies everything.
Well, right now we're using officially we have the D20 combat system, and we have the Tri Tac combat system. The two I would actually prefer using the D20.
Yeah.
Because Tri Tac combat system is probably the most complex system, right next to what was that Rollmaster?
Yeah. Right. But like so if you were playing it, if you played the D20 version, so you could play any D20 book or module out there that's compatible with the OGL. So you could
Any OGL, any OGL book.
Any of them, right?
Yeah. You just follow the rules of the actual physical universe of Fringeworthy.
Right.
You're okay.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, and theoretically, with a little tweaking, you might be able to even play a Pathfinder game.
Sure. Sure.
Yeah.
We worked it out. We went everywhere no matter what game we were playing. We would start off with Vampire and wind up going everywhere, and we would just like say, I guess this is what it's going to do.
And Fringeworthy sort of is the tie together game because there's a portal to Bureau 13, there's a portal to FTL, Richard says there's a portal to Hard Wired Hinterland, but that sort of breaks the scheme because it's impossible based on what he's told me.
Right.
But he says there's a portal. To FTL.
Hey, never underestimate Richard's ability to not be consistent. So then, you know, you have that, and then we have Bureau 13, which is it's a Monster Hunter game. I mean, it's really, you know, pure and simply, you can be Buffy, or you can be Men in Black, or you can be, and what's the rule, John? If anything that can be real is?
All stories are true.
There you go. So
that means on Mars, there are Wellsian Martians, there's Swiftian Martians, there is, basically all the various Martians you're thinking of, including the Martians from Mars Attacks, they're there too.
Well, it's whatever the game.
All these work together. We don't. Yeah. Whatever the game master. There's Selenites on the moon.
Right.
Yeah. Look for the large crater with the big glass dome.
So Bureau 13 came out in D20 as well. So those two work together really well. As a matter of fact, those two are probably the best to work together. I think. Those two games work together better than any of his other games. Mm-hmm. And then we have Hardwired Hinterland, which is neat.
Yeah, like I said, Hardwired Hinterland is the straight. Basically, you were walking, driving, whatever, and you made an abrupt left turn, and now you're standing on a beach, being attacked by giant squids. You know, that's your welcome to the hinterland. At that point,
I build a fire.
These squids. These squids will rip you apart. They're like the squid. When I say squids, remember Disney's the 20,000 Leagues.
Are you talking about like Cthulhu?
Yeah.
Cthulhu walks up on the beach.
Cthulhu is not a squid, sir.
But it's really weird. The easy way to describe it is it's someplace else. As best you can tell, it's a flat world.
Is that a cat?
Yeah, that's
okay.
My cat.
Okay.
He's cat dementia, and occasionally he just, like, randomly walks into a room and just, like, I don't know what's going on in his head, but he's like, what? Oh god, it's all just caving in on me right now. Sorry about the random cat noises, but
no,
I haven't seen our cat.
That's fine. That was just funny. It sounded, I could first try to figure out if it was a kid or a cat.
It's my slave. My child slave labor is how I get my costumes done.
Okay, that works.
Yeah, but yeah.
So how many different settings have you guys tried in your campaign? Like, do they all kind of flow together pretty well?
When I ran my playtest for Savage Worlds, I didn't actually. I basically had not antebellum, but basically it was a place where the there is the one alternate world where the colonies did not revolt. Benjamin Franklin was the governor of the American Commonwealth. There was no revolution, and now it's 1860 something. The British are talking about ending slavery, and of course that's bad news for all the planters in the South. Then we went to Victorian world, which is steampunk world, the Victorian prime, which is steampunk world, and they had lots of fun there, lots of adventures there. Steampunk world is a mixture of H.G. Wells, a little Jules Verne, and a little Conan Doyle, because it didn't meet Sherlock Holmes. And Mycroft is actually the one who runs the British operation. So they didn't meet Sherlock Holmes. He's a legendary character, and they had no chance against him. They decided to have a little spar, and he wiped the floor with their best fighter. and then we took them to the Mongols, and they had a lot of fun with the Mongols. With the Great Khan, not Genghis, but like, you know, we decided it would be like third generation from Genghis. I think we decided. So, no, it can't be because it was 1500s.
Just to give you guys all a little background on John. Yeah. When you ask John about the games he plays, he is what we like to call a grognard. he'll sit down and go, well, in 1863, this faction didn't happen, which meant the fall of this government, and then these two other governments.
I work it out.
He goes through the steps. Now, I'll tell you from our groups. Oh, yeah. Our groups, when we played Fringeworthy, we were known to sometimes not start on Earth. We'd start on one of the other worlds that they go to. So, like our most famous adventure, Mike, you remember all this? We started out in Cyberpunk. And then our characters discovered the Fringe Path. We were cyborgs, basically, and edge runners. So when we discovered the Fringe Path, we were not quite as nice as the other explorers because we weren't what you would call explorers.
we weren't IDET material.
we were more in the look at what we found category. Then our cybernetic characters wound up becoming like vampires and werewolves and shit. We mixed it all up. It was crazy. It was fun. It was a good time. It was a good time. But yeah, you can do all that. I mean, you can get crazy with it. You can go super science, super technical. It can be an exercise in your own personal little sociological experiment, or you can be like we were, or anywhere in between, and be like. Like, I need robots, a wizard, and a Gatling gun. <You know? laughs> and those two wouldn't mix. I said robot. Give me a robot. So
how does the character building work? Like, do you kind of get to like pick and choose and add stuff from like the different worlds you go to, or is it kind of like you start with one thing and like you just keep leveling up that thing?
Well, it really depends on the system you're going to use. I mean, if you are using D20, you're stuck in a D20 system where you're going, you got character classes, and we actually have some advanced, we created some advanced classes for that in D20. In the original system, original system had, Richard had over 300 skills in the original system.
Yeah, it wasn't a class system, it was a kind of a point system, kind of a skill
Well, you rolled rand in his system. You rolled randomly for your stats.
Right.
And then
so it's like a mastery system.
Yeah. Yeah, basically you get good in something. Hand-to-hand combat was such that when I ran it way back when, my players would look at, you could go as hand-to-hand combat or pull your gun out and shoot them. They would pull out the gun and shoot them.
Yeah.
Because it's easier than the hand-to-hand combat.
And then the Savage Worlds version, I mean, that's classless, so it's...
It's classless, but it does have ranks. So you have ranks as you go up. But it's also fairly low skills. It's like about 15 skills, 20 skills, something like that.
But you know what I like about the Savage Worlds, though, John, is that system's going to be very easy for somebody to say, well, I'm going to play a cowboy from the 1880 world. And you would say, well, I'm gonna play an astronaut from 2050, and I'm just gonna play a regular IDET guy, and they'd all play together just fine. I think that's a big bonus of Savage Worlds.
In Savage Worlds, what makes your characters different are your edges and hindrances. You get when you start up, you pick a major hindrance and two minor hindrances to flesh out his problems. And then you pick different edges, and it's the edges that give you that really define your character and make him different from everyone else. So and some edges will become available as you go to various places and learn things. So
left out, John? All right, so a big thing about Fringeworthy, and this is like a game balancing kind of leveling the field kind of thing. Only 1 in 100,000 people. And it's totally random. And even Richard said that. There's no rhyme or reason to it. It's completely random. Only 1 in 100,000 people can walk through the portal. Everyone else can't go through the portals. They can't travel through them. So
what would happen if I make up this whole awesome character and then I don't get to go through the portal?
You're funny, Mike. Wow. If you make up a character, it's assumed that you are one of the chosen.
Going through. Yeah.
Maybe your character just like sits outside the portal. And like wait till people come back and it's like, what was it like?
I'll guard the portal, guys.
Hold yourself up.
Everybody roll initiative. Okay. What do, Pete? I watch the portal. You do that every round. Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, in my last game I ran, we had an ex-Air Force computer tech. We had a TV evangelist, a ex-Spetsnaz. A Russian commando, a Spanish knight, modern day Spanish knight, and a photographer. That was team two, And I lost two of the guys because I lost the photographer because he just couldn't make it. But yeah, we had But yeah, it was fun watching these people with complete disparate skills, and then later on, Paul joined us. And he decided he's going to be a Victorian, so he's playing Victorians. So he's playing a Victorian detective who basically was found out to be Fringeworthy.
Okay.
And the NPC team is Earl Greystone with his friend and manservant Cosgrove Shropshire, who despite his name is Congolese.
Okay.
He's got a little British in his blood. Lee Chan, and we decided that her grandmother is Jackie Chan's great grandmother, so they're related.
So you
and who else? And my grandfather.
Okay,
I put my grandfather in there. Yeah, he was an engineer. So
well, I hope you're treating him well. Well, and you know what? This what I love about this is the fact that it's a random 1 in 100,000 people. If you want to be realistic about it, you're not going to be saying, everyone's not going to be playing a special forces guy because that just doesn't make sense. It gives you the ability to make very interesting characters. Like one of the things I had proposed to the guys was saying that would be neat would be the driver for the team is like maybe an Iraqi taxi cab driver. He's used to driving in war zones around IEDs and people shooting him and stuff. So he's used to he has an actual valid reason for having a character who's experienced in combat driving, right? So and he'd also be kind of hardened, you know. He'd be this guy that you know, he wouldn't be easily to be shaken. He's used to bombs going off near him and stuff. And it's like, that's just a kind of a neat way to have a character who's you know, who has a specialty. This is where you bring your veterinarian in, who's your team doctor. You know, he's like, I studied to be a veterinarian, but when I found out I was Fringeworthy, I learned a little bit more about people, and I'm the team doc. You know, because
yeah, this guy worry when he opens up his pack of rubber gloves. He has the gloves that was up to here.
Oh, the shoulder. Yeah, horse's
examination time. It's like, Doc, what are you doing? That's the only gloves I got, man.
It's like Richard Wellhagen. These are all I have. Right.
You know what they say? When all you have is a hammer, everything's a nail.
I mean, we actually have some great examples in the game built in. Like the team one is a scientist. A manager for a Chinese fish farm, a bicycle messenger, and a writer who has connections to the Russian mob.
Nice. but it gives you, yeah, it really gives you a lot of leeway to make some really, really interesting characters. Because, you know, being that you're valuable, if they find out you're Fringeworthy, they want you, they'll recruit you, they'll pay you a lot of money to do it. So,
well, I'm making this straight. The people who pay you lots of money is not the United Nations, which organized this. It's your country's paying you this lot of money to do this, because they want to make sure you bring back stuff for them.
That represent the home team, buddy.
All right, so hey, John, we're running a little long on this. Let's hurry up and go through the other games of Tri Tac just real quick, so that we can move on.
I mean, we pretty much covered them. I mean, you know, just quick, you know, quick recap. We got FTL 2448. Beer 13, Stalking the Night, fantastic. Fringeworthy. Then we have Incursion. Then we have Hard Wired Hinterland, Weird Zone.
Wait, hey, real Cloisters. Quick. Stop on Hard Wired Hinterland, because I don't think we explained that well. So Hard Wired Hinterland, real quick, it's what they call these environs. So they're square patches of land.
Environs,
yeah. What's the size on those?
They're 200 square miles across. They're 200 miles by 200 miles, and they're separated by 200 miles of ocean. And best way to describe this is Tales of the Golden Monkey crossed with Tailspin.
Right. And each one of those environs is a different like setting. So one of them's like a dinosaur island. Another one is called Little Texas. What's another one? Etowah.
New Akron, the Libertarian Paradise.
Etowah is like the jungle.
Yeah. Oh no, it's the only place that actually has water. You can actually land in and not get attacked by whales, the carnivore whales and squids.
Okay.
Yeah, it actually has walls around the island, so it's basically tall walls, and then you have all these little Polynesian islands.
Okay.
And you got new old New York, almost Canada. You've got Anston's Kingdom. You have Magic Costs, where it's basically it's a place where magic works, and it's also a deadly dangerous. And then right next to Technicost, there's two places you really don't want to go to. Magic Costs and the Techno World, where it's basically, you know, Terminators and some of that walk around shooting people.
I don't think I want to go there. I don't want to go there.
Yeah, and there's a bunch of other places too. I mean, there's other places too, but yeah, it's a little community, and then of course they find out there's a copy. Well, not a copy, but it's the same thing above them, about 1,000 miles.
Yeah, if you fly straight up for 1,000 miles, there's another set of worlds. Face, you kind of do a flip over at the midway point. So you flip around.
Now here's the funny thing: you got to do it at night. If you try it during the day, you'll hit the. You hit the sun layer and burn up.
Okay. And then there's
of course the other problem is that the sun layer is almost pure helium or pure hydrogen.
Oh, you don't want yeah.
Oh, I was gonna say pure helium.
Right. No, it's pure hydrogen. No smoking, please. All right, then there's Weird Zone. Talk about that just real quick. Explain that real quick, because that's a cool game. I mean, it's you know what, and I'll tell you, I thought it was...
It's sliders, only instead of just you have a little portal. It's basically your house, and everything within 100 to 150 feet of that house have gone sliding to other worlds, and you have no control over it.
Yeah, your house randomly picks up and disappears.
Yep. And when I ran it, the folks have said they're going to be a Alaskan bush pilot. And we went and actually, I actually found a Quonset hut hangar up in Alaska and said, there it is. Took a picture of it in Google, made a map, and there we went. And everything on the map is what they had. So they had a hangar and parts of hangars. They had some extra airplanes. I said, most of them are broken. And four and one half cars.
Now, all right, so here's...
Because unfortunately, anything out the edge when you get bobbled and sent off someplace else, it's sliced off completely. Ooh, so yeah, now, one game I ran, they appeared and half a Mastodon fell over.
My luggage! Nice.
So yeah, but here's the important thing: once you're on that plot and it takes off, you're now part of that plot. So when it lands, if you get off and run for the hills, when it disappears again, you get teleported back to it. So you can't just get away from it.
Hmm. Oh man.
We figure the only way you can get away with it is if A, you're Fringeworthy. You find a Fringeworthy portal, you step through, and then now you've broken the connection.
Right.
Or you get another zero plot is what they're called. One of these little bubble plots.
Because they go flying through space. They go flying through this like inner space, and they pass each other and stuff. So like sometimes it'd be like you could have them pass each other, and guys shooting at each other and jumping off across from one to the other. And that's the only time you could transfer from one plot to another.
I did confirm with Richard, you can make your plot bigger, but you have to be sneaky about it. You literally have to cut a trench through the middle, mm-hmm. push it apart, making sure it's still connected, then fill in the hole.
Oh, okay.
And it gets bigger that way.
And then it gets even more screwed up because when you're flying through space, you know, you can encounter things like it can rain zombies or it can rain fire.
I want neither of those things.
Well, not zombies. No, not zombies. No. Don't worry about zombies. Demons and angels. That's the ones you got to worry about.
Okay.
Showing up.
And you got to remember, your plot doesn't have power or water or any of that kind of stuff. So if you're flying through space for a couple of days, you could be a couple of days without water on that thing.
Yeah,
sounds like a Hunger Games thing.
Well, the first thing my team did was turn off the valve on the hot water heater so they wouldn't siphon out. So they had a big hot water heater full of water. But unfortunately, they couldn't use the toilets because they used the little blue things in the toilets.
Oh, nice.
So the toilets were worth it.
Don't drink that.
But they also were getting ready for a flight out to the country. You know, basically, it's the pilot and a scientist. And a hunter, and one of the NPCs was the secretary who ran the business. And they're still alive, even though after encountering things such as aliens, greys with their Westworld setup. Yeah, they had the aliens had a Westworld, and then they met the place where people worship cows because cows make them worship them.
Oh God!
Cows.
All right, so let's. We're about on time, so I want to give my co-host a second, Mike or Allegra or Brian. Do you have any other questions you want to ask about any of these Tri Tac games we've been talking about? Anything we glossed over that you want to highlight on or ask about?
Yeah.
Anything at
all? not that, but there was something that you mentioned in the beginning that you wanted to touch on, and I'm still interested too. It was, and I cannot remember what. You talked about it, something storytelling or something, utility, something like a utility kind of a thing or a service or something.
Oh, shit, yeah, John, real quick, your sci-fi, the sci-fi site that you work with.
Oh, yes, yeah. My other claim to fame is I'm actually one of the contributors now, actually one of the staff now on a website called SciFi Ideas. I'll shoot Peter the web link to it, but the SciFi Ideas is a site created by a pair of Brits, and basically it's what it sounds like. They have this full different ideas. Mark, his name is Merval, the guy who runs it. But it has a slow start, but now it's picked up. It basically has articles. Artifexian, the guy who does the things on how to build worlds. He's a staff member too, so we'll get his videos up there as well. We will have story ideas. We actually will have jumping off points. Oh yeah, I got several up there. I also got a couple stories up there too. So
oh, cool.
I also won the every August he does a competition of the best alien creature in under I think 600 words, and I won this year or cool. last year with my alien race, the Kutali, a species that grew up learning to talk with radio waves and not sound. So first contact would be interesting with them.
Yeah, you know, and I was looking through that site a little bit today, and I noticed there was a lot of stuff they'll do is they'll give you like a story seed, so it'll be like two paragraphs, and it'll describe a situation. Mm-hmm. And and a lot of times it looks like they're accompanied by a picture. It was this big worm with all these balloons hanging off of it, and it was a story about something, and you should never bring a wizard to a party, and that's your starting point, and then you're expected to write a story, use that as your basis, and then write a story from that.
Oh, that one's fun to read for the comments, because people were ripping them a new one about the fact that you got fantasy in my science fiction.
Yeah. Two great genres that go great together.
But they also have a lot of stuff, like they actually have real science on there, like scientific ideas and scientific concepts that are very real, you know, things that scientists are working on or things that we know. And it's like just stuff.
And then they have Star Trek science too, but yeah.
Right, but I'm just saying.
They have Star Trek science.
They have stuff where you can you can take this idea and say, you know what, I could do a story out of that. I could make a story out of that cool science concept.
Yeah.
And lots of art and stuff. It's pretty neat.
Oh yeah, it's there was a story idea. Actually, if you go through, you'll see an idea story based on this picture, which was also based. Another person did used the same picture too. So we actually in 1 month, two of us submitted a story for the same picture, and Mark decided to post them both. So and totally radical different takes on that picture. So
sweet.
I'd like to see that happen more often. Yeah.
Right. That's neat to see where it takes a writer.
Yeah, right now I got a story. I have a story in there right now. It's kind of contemporary because it's about the digital currency.
Bitcoin.
Just waiting for Mark to go over. Well, I'm not using that name because a that's trademark. Right. I'm calling Digicoins.
Right. Yeah. Hell, Brian might have a story on Bitcoin tonight.
Bitcoins, they're like Pokemon. Yeah. In fact, they are Pokemon.
Yeah, pretty much.
Gotta catch them all.
All right, so John, let's get some links. Where do we get Tri Tac stuff?
Links.
Oh. Links? Well, Links Rex. Well, there's a podcast, so I'm going to pop our podcast first, because we actually have one of our most popular podcasts so far. It's about cats.
Really? That's the most popular one? Because I know it was something about like getting more podcast listeners.
Are you surprised that people thought about cats?
in the past week, the episode on Hard Wired Hinterland, Cat Rulers, has close to 180 plays, according to the website.
In 1 week. Not too bad.
In 1 week.
Not too bad.
Oh, so you would have gotten more hits if it was keyboard cats.
Yeah. Well, this okay. Cause
or grumpy
we're
cats.
We're doing Podbeam. So if we go on to the actual stats, we'll actually get a different set of numbers. Mm-hmm. This is people who played it just here on the website. Doesn't count plays through iTunes. Doesn't count plays through other means, through a RSS feed, which I fixed.
Oh, did you?
Our RSS feed up to RPG Podcast was broken, so I fixed it.
Really? Oh, shit. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, right. Anyway. And,
so how do we find that podcast?
That one is tritacsystems.podbean.com. That's tritacsystems.podbean.com.
And how many episodes?
That's the main one. Then, of course, there's our well, 333 episodes, officially 258, but we have a bunch of filler episodes. I don't think – does Bruce actually count our – yeah, he did count the Christmas one.
Right.
So, yeah. And we try to keep him honest. We actually did – I'm waiting for it to come through. We did an actual play. Sorry, Peter, did you make that, Peter?
Yeah, was that the fiasco?
The actual play?
The fiasco?
Yeah, we did – I put together a fiasco playset for Hardware Hinterland.
Yeah, we played that. The brass monkey ball.
Yes, the brass monkey ball, and because the Hardware Hinterland is such a strange place. I said it needs an intro game of some sort. Right. So you get your head around it a little bit, and that's what I did. I created the brass monkey ball, and so the next one. Let me go get here. I'm getting my links up so I can get the links right. There we go. So our main website, if you want to get any of our games, is tritacgames.com. That's tritacgames.com. And of course we have four, there's links in there to our forums, everything else that you can. But the Tri Tac Games, we finally have started providing download service for our games. We used to sell them on CDs, but now we actually have a where you can purchase and download them directly to your hard drive.
Wait, stop, so, stop. How did you convince Richard of that?
Yes.
Was there
Melody did, using her white owls.
Okay, I was going to say, was there a gun involved? No, there was not a gun involved. There was a woman involved. Much more powerful. Much more powerful.
Yeah. Besides, she's administrating the site. She wanted to make her life easier.
There you go. Awesome. Good. Good news. I'm glad he joined the modern age.
Yeah. So, yes, you can purchase them through there. What else?
Oh, and your sci-fi site.
And, of course, there is our Yahoo site. Well, we have the Yahoo group, which has been around for ages. We have Yahoo group for the three main games, Bureau 13, Fringeworthy, and FTL 2448. But they're moribund right now. They're more or less only James Buchanan posts on Fringeworthy.
You would find that you're really going to find your traction on Facebook. That's probably where most of the discussion happens, right?
Or the forums.
And you can get to those through the website, right?
The link to them is up. Yes, I'll have to try the game's website. There's free stuff up there, including the playset for Fiasco. So download it, and if you like it, buy a copy of the game, or buy a copy of the game and download it. Nice. I'm happy either way.
Where can they buy a copy of any of the Tri Tac games? Are they available on DriveThruRPG?
Off the website. TriTacGames.com.
Tri Tac. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you get them there. Game Richard actually go to a distributor is going to be kind of hard ever since he had bad situations with other distributors in the past.
Okay. And he just does sole distribution. All right.
And if you ever want to try out a Tri Tac game, and if you're at Dragon Con, Bruce always runs games at Dragon Con. He always runs games at Gen Con. And John, you usually run stuff out your way, right? Like Fantasy Flight or.
Yeah. No, Dragonflight.
Dragonflight.
Yeah, I try at least try to run a Bureau 13 game. Yeah, Bureau 13 game. This year I'm going to Game Storm down in Vancouver, Washington. But I'm not running any Tri Tac games down there. I'm actually running several Fate games.
Okay.
So.
All right. Awesome.
I gain more traction that way. Those games. And also, we have our Facebook group. We have the fans of the Tri Tac podcast. We had the fans of the fans of Fringeworthy, and the Bureau 13 fans, agents everywhere. So, and we also have a page, the Tri Tac Games page. And we have if you want to get in on the Savage Worlds design, the Savage Worlds Fringeworthy design page. But that's basically, let me know you want to join, and I'll let you in. But it's that one you can join easily. It's by only just re-ask and I'll let you in.
Cool.
Do people share a lot of their like game stories and stuff?
Some of them do, especially when they're weird or wonderful. Then they'll share them. I couldn't believe what those guys did.
Right.
Type stories, but nah.
And so you guys know, if you do get bitten by the Fringeworthy bug or any of the Tri Tac Games bug. And you wanna get more. The podcast that we do is, like John said, it's 333 episodes, and we talk about everything under the sun about that game and all different concepts and character concepts and game mastering tips and player tips and, I don't know, all kinds of shit. I mean, we did a whole series on role-playing during a disaster. So, like, not you in a disaster, like, not trying to roll the dice while a hurricane is blowing your house down, but, like, while your character's in a hurricane, and we all pick different things. Like, one of us did a thing on a volcano, if you had a volcano eruption in the area, how you would do rules for that. How you would play during like a flood or a hurricane or a fire, all that kind of stuff.
Earthquake.
Yeah, earthquake. And that was one series that we did. We do a series on equipping your characters. We do a series on game mastering tips on what to put on your character sheet, all that kind of stuff. So go check it out. There's plenty of resources.
Yeah, I'll plug one of our later ones. We did one on, actually I got right here, right in front of me. Where is it? There we go. No, we haven't. It's not here yet. It's not up yet. But actually, it's still in the can, so it hasn't been released yet. We actually did one on character motivations. You know, why is your character, you know, for Fringe really, but this can actually apply to any game. Basically, questions like, why is your character going out here? Besides, it's not the money.
Right.
Why is your character getting up in the morning, crossing the snow, going down into the Arctic ice, and walking into that portal? Why is he doing it, or right. She is doing it? What's their motivation? You know, and that can actually be hooks for the GM to set plot points up on for.
Right.
And those things are good, folks. Especially my friends out there who keep telling me, "Quick, give the GM's GM ideas." But you know what? Give ideas, because sometimes the GM's stuck.
Right. And we've picked all the genres. Like, we've picked, you know, how would you role play in a dinosaur world? So your Fringeworthy characters go to a dinosaur world. What is there to do there? How does that really work? We did a whole episode on that. We did a whole one on everything you can imagine. Japan, ancient Japan, westerns.
Not much on westerns. I don't think we haven't actually.
We did one. Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. We did do one in the Wild West. Yeah. But that was more Bureau 13 than it was Fringeworthy.
But still,
well, yeah.
Still all good ideas. All right, everybody. That's it, John. Thank you very much for coming on. You going to stick around and play a game with us?
Thank you. Sure. Yeah, I'll lose. I mean, I'll try.
All right. Go play Tri Tac Games and buy all their stuff. It's a lot of fun. Get hooked. It's good stuff. All right, Mike, are you ready?
Yep.
Hello? Uh-oh, what happened to your sound, brother?
You're muted, Mike.
Sorry.
Okay. All right.
I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm ready.
Ah!
All right, here we go.
Mike, what's
what's weird with you?
What's the game this week, Mike?
Today, and I'm using the makeshift soundboard. Today, as I hit this button, if I hit that button,
what about this button?
Let me hit this button.
Damn you guys! All right, hold on. I gotta shoot this. Buttons. When I do that. And that.
Ah, there we go.
And then I do that.
All right, so
are we
hold
good?
On. Go. Wait a minute.
Yay.
1 second.
You got to click on it, Peter, so it stays up in the screen.
No, I got it.
Otherwise,
it
disappears.
I got it.
You got it.
I'm just trying to. I got to turn on this here.
Oh, that's right, because if Google Plus will, if you do a screen share, it drops it.
No, I'm good. Just give me
are
one.
Are you ready?
No, give me 1 second, because you're the size of it's off, of course. Because for whatever reason,
big.
The size changed again, because before the size was set up fine, and now it's not.
Okay,
there's that. Let me move it over here. Let me shrink that down.
Sorry.
Do you have time?
I don't know, you changed the size of it.
Peter, do I have time to go out and get a drink real quick?
If you make it real quick.
All right, I'll just kill my camera.
Which means go now, go,
no, go, move.
You have 10 seconds.
9. All right, eight. Mike, your screen is set up for survey says, but we'll wait for John to get back. He'll only be a minute.
Right.
Five.
How does this sound? Is the music too loud if I'm talking over it like this? All right.
It's fine.
And I'm back.
Yeah, what
All right,
what
John.
What are you doing with our settings, man?
Man.
All right, we're ready to go.
Should I not start yet?
Yep,
okay.
You're good to go, Mike.
John, MythWits panelists, we are about to play Survey Says version 2.0. Yay. Welcome to the new and improved MythWits Survey Says. I am your host, Michael Cthulhu Cephas. Survey Says is simple. 100 people have been surveyed online and at various conferences around the world. These survey questions are geeky in nature, and you must do your best to guess the most popular to answer the of answers to these survey questions. Each round, player order will be determined by a decahedral random number generator. One of those things. Why is that there? That player has the first attempt at guessing a survey answer. Each player will receive up to two opportunities to guess survey answers. If your provided survey answer matches any of the top recorded survey answers, you will receive that total in points. The player with the most points at the end of the five rounds, or there are actually are three rounds this time, will be crowned this week's Survey Says Overlord. In the event of a two or more way tie, a decahedral random number generator will be determined the player order for the tiebreaker round. And here we go. And here we go. Number one. Oh, here is the that. And now I will be rolling down in the order in the window. So basically I'm rolling for Allegra first. Allegra, you get a 5. Brian, you get a 10. Oh. And, of course, 10s are better than 5s. And John, you get a 7.
I'm coming for you, Brian.
And Peter gets a 3.
Yay!
So, we have Brian, John, Allegra, and Peter. Okay, so, basically, name a popular way you would like to see the world end. Now, I'm going to tell you guys this. This was at a media, or at a, how would you define Balticon? It's not just a MediaCon. It's a book authors.
It's mostly authors, yeah.
Author con.
It's a sci-fi con.
It's very cerebral. A lot of the people that are cerebral, some of these answers you're not going to necessarily agree with, but you got to go with what the surveyor's survey says.
And remember, this is not you.
Yeah.
This is what they said.
Right. So you're trying to think in terms of that. So basically, I'm going to go down the list. Brian, John, Allegra, and then Pete, you will give me one answer, and then we'll go down again, and each of you can give me two answers, and then we'll run down and see if we get it. So, Brian, name a popular way you would like to see the world end.
You gotta go with the zombie apocalypse.
And John.
Okay, let's see. Oh, well, let's go for an oldie but goodie, thermonuclear war.
Well. And Allegra.
Machine uprising.
Oh, good one.
Nice. Nice.
Mm-hmm. All right, and Peter.
Oh, I'm going to say asteroids.
You got a lotion for that.
There have been 7 preparations before H. So,
The supermarket was out, and oh, they burn.
All right, Brian, for your second go round.
I don't know, Pete. The asteroids already had their shot at Earth.
Right, that's true. They did. They passed
every
by
day. Every day they have a shot at us.
It's all the time.
The Earth gets. The Earth gets bigger by a few kilograms every day from asteroid dust.
Pretty much.
Brian, your second opportunity.
I'm going to tweak this opportunity with viral outbreak.
Oh, so non-zombie specific.
I'm going to tweak it with viral outbreak.
Okay. John.
The Grey Goo Disaster. Ooh, nanomachines just, eat the world.
So we're going with like the blob?
No, it's a
Grey
nano,
goo.
Nano.
They
goo.
Just made a game about Grey Goo. They actually just did.
Yeah. Okay.
Great. Yeah, basically called the nanomachine apocalypse.
Okay.
How's that? Yeah.
Gotcha. And Allegra.
This is my second guess?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Alien invasion.
Oh, that was going to be my second one.
Oh. And Peter.
Oh, well, she just
what
took
you got, Pete? What you got, Pete?
She just took mine, damn it. let me think.
Oh, that's going to be hard.
Yes, that's gonna. Yes, definitely gonna be hard.
Harken back to sci-fi movies. You got this.
Death Star.
I'm gonna say the Hadron Collider.
Ooh.
The Hadron Collider.
Ooh. Malfunction with the collider.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I actually thought of a better.
Or in this case.
making black holes.
So wait a minute, are you talking about a black hole, or are you talking about the Hadron Collider creating a black hole, or how do you want to quantify that?
It's specifically the Hadron Collider. Like the thought is that it would make a black hole.
All right. Okay, so even Pete's last answer could have been first. We're going to just run down the list because that's how it has to go. But the number one answer, or name a popular way you would like to see the world end, is... Alien Invasion.
Nice.
That gives Allegra 18 points.
Mm.
And the second most popular answer for how people would like to see the world end is Robot Uprising.
Nice.
Allegra again.
Allegra.
Damn.
Can I think like the masses or what?
Yeah,
yes,
no doubt.
You can.
Christ, the last time we played this, a girl beat us. Damn it.
Girls are survey sayers.
Gotta represent, Jen.
Here we go. Number three. Kaiju or any other monsters, etc.
Oh, yeah,
nope.
That's a good one.
Brian.
Seriously.
What was I thinking?
I know. And number four.
What?
Supernova, which I can't say is a black hole induced by anything.
That doesn't fit.
Yeah. And like I'm telling you, I agree that, you know, one of these that one person gave me that did not make the list, I am shocked. Shocked, I tell you. So here we go. Number five. Cosmological entropy. I would have accepted heat death universe.
Oh, God.
Like I said,
that's a mouthful.
That's the lamest answer ever. That's like that's basically how would you like the Earth to die? Old age.
Exactly.
Well, would you have taken the big rip for that?
Right. Yeah. Sure. Right. Same thing.
Yeah.
The big. All right. The big
number
rip.
Six. Ice Age. Again, how lame.
That's lame.
Right? I thought about that, too.
I know.
Come on, peeps. Viral outbreak.
Yeah, what's up?
Listen. Well, let's see. Number seven.
Mass orgasm. Awesome.
Or, as they like to say, death by snoo-snoo.
Okay. So,
all right.
So
technically, it's death by crushed pelvises.
Wait a minute.
Planet
So I'm going down this list here, and I'm seeing only one person getting points here, and it was a lot of them.
That is correct.
Shit.
Right. That gives 34 points to Allegra. Wow.
I like this game.
I made this game for you, Allegra.
Yay.
See, I thought you went to a science fiction convention. It sounds like you went to a sci-fi convention.
It is. It's a sci-fi convention. Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
I don't know. That last answer sounds like you went to a different kind of convention.
Oh, we wish. We wish. Damn it.
Oh, what? Oh, what? What, the AVN
in awards,
convention?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah,
exactly.
We're going to do our right. podcast there.
So,
Death by Dildo.
Here's our next round. Hey, listen, guys, anyone is still in it, okay? So here we go. The question, name a popular window or bumper decal found on a geek's car. And we're going to roll for initiative. Wow. Allegra gets a 10.
Oh, you suck.
No, that's the low one.
No, that's the high
one. No, that's the high one.
That's the high one.
Yes. Brian gets a 2.
Gives him more time to think. I'm cool.
That's right. John gets a 9.
Ooh.
Second again.
And Pete gets an 8.
Okay.
So I guess we do Allegra. And John. And... who's that other guy? Pete.
Yeah.
And then that last guy, Brian.
Brian.
Okay, so we'll just go down the list again. We'll start with Allegra. Allegra, name a popular window or bumper decal found on a geek's car. Now, these I will kind of help you guys out a little bit, and if you guess more specific and it falls under the umbrella of the greater answer, you get the points. But there are sort of themed portion, so there are, you know, you can fall within something. Right. Even if you go specific, you can still fall into it. So...
Well, like, how general can we go, though? Can I just say Star Trek?
Do you want to say just anything Star Trek? You can say anything Star Trek to cover your bases.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so hold on. Wait, or, Mike. Or, Mike, hold on.
Yeah.
If someone else...
That
if, hold on, wait. No, listen. I got it. If someone else guesses more specific and is that specific one, they snag it.
Where is this from?
No, that is not how it will work.
Well, listen.
How it will work is you will...
No, because you have to, dude. Because, like, if she says Star Trek and I say Enterprise and the guy said Enterprise sticker, then who gets it?
We should both get it.
Yeah, it's
cheap. What is this, kindergarten? Jesus Christ.
No, you can't just say fucking Star Trek.
That's okay, what I just said.
Go vague. I want my guess. I want my... Wait, so go vague?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I was going to go really specific. Doctor Who? Stuff? TARDISes?
Okay.
Really, like, the first thing I thought of was that fucking coexist bumper sticker. The one that's got, like, all the different symbols. From, like,
I can only write one thing down right now. You spewed out about 3 things, which is helping everyone else. But what would you like me to write down for your first answer since you're number 1?
I want to go with the coexist one, actually.
Okay.
A good feeling about it. Mm. Nobody else take my other guesses.
Okay.
Okay, done deal. John.
Well... considering that I have it on my motorbike, the Firefly registration sticker.
So he's saying Firefly.
Basically, the vehicle, Firefly. Yes.
Yeah. Gotcha. Peter,
I'm going with the zombie family. You know, like the little mom and
that's
dad and
a good
kids,
one.
The zombie one.
Yeah.
All right. Brian.
First guess, I'm gonna go with a Sith Empire, like, election bumper sticker, like Palpatine 2015 or Palpatine 2016. So, an election sticker for Emperor Palpatine.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. And, Allegra, your second answer?
Okay, definitely, like, a TARDIS.
Or my other vehicle's a TARDIS.
Yeah, like something TARDIS-related.
John.
Let's see... I got a couple floating in my head.
You got a floater?
No. No, but I do got... I have to actually go see a doctor about my retina. I actually have I have little holes in my retina, so I need to get them fixed.
Oh.
Thanks a lot, Pete.
No,
it's awful.
And John.
Yeah, anyway, John, yes. TMI, yeah. Let's see. Oh, gee, I was gonna go with a Darwin fish, but that's actually not a bumper sticker. That's actual.
That works.
thing which
that is
okay. It says
that
window
okay.
decal.
Yeah, it works. But no. I was going to go with that. I had something to bear in mind. Of course, my brain wandered. What was it? Now let's go with the Darwin fish. Yeah, Darwin fish.
Okay. And Peter.
Apple logo.
And Brian.
Transformer icon. Either Autobots or Decepticons.
Good one.
Okay.
Transformers.
This worked out okay. You guys all answered, so no one covered over each other. Hopefully you guys won't be all pissy with the, I was going to say it. So, here we go.
But Mike, I said that.
I was going to say that.
That's bullshit, Mike. It's bullshit.
Answer. 4, name a popular window or bumper or metal type of plasticky decal found on a geek's car is...
Oh,
it exists.
I hate you.
Mm-hmm. I had such a good feeling about it.
Hate you.
And the number 2 answer. You know, number 2 isn't as shitty as number 3, but it's still better than number 4. Is Star Wars anything? And that
bam.
Brian, 14 points. And the number 3 answer, Doctor Who anything?
Man.
Finally, I'm on the board.
TARDIS counts, right?
Yes, Doctor
yes.
Who.
Yes. That's how he gets around.
I'm getting killed.
All right, guys. And the number 4 answer for name a popular window bumper decal found on a geek's car is Star Trek anything. Nobody went with Star Trek.
I actually had something written down, which
yeah.
was funny. But.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I went with Transformers.
That's okay.
I thought the Transformers one was good.
Yeah. Who knows? Maybe it'll like make the list. Oh, wait a minute. I know. And the number 5 answer is the Darwin Evolve
yes.
or SNES.
Oh.
Nice.
Yes.
I get 8
nice.
Points. Yay.
Nice.
8 points, Johnny.
Johnny, baby.
Johnny, 8 points.
And Peter has 0.
I've got 0. Big fucking donut.
There's 3 left, Pete. You still got this.
The number yeah. 6 answer for a popular window bumper sticker found on a geek's car is family anything.
Hey!
Family!
I'm in the game. I'm in the game.
You're in the game. Yay! Hercules!
Last. Last place.
Hey, now, but it's a place, okay?
Yeah.
If I were to tell you guys that there is still at least one answer that somebody will get points for, does that make anyone excited?
Mm,
yeah.
Anyone except for Allegra, because she's already blown her 2 answers. So, here we go.
Yeah.
Number 7 answer. D&D anything. Nobody went with D&D anything.
I roll national 20 in bed.
Come on, guys.
0 charisma.
Like you crit on the first try? Like, I don't know about that, man.
Want to see my holy Avenger?
Oh. Can I put it in your portable hole?
And the number 8 answer, which will get somebody points on the board, is Transformers anything.
Yay!
Ryan gets 4 points. With his Transformers.
I officially hate this game.
Okay, so now that is... I
don't want to be Allegra, Peter. I just got to beat you.
Yeah, I know, right? Seriously. Good luck with that.
31 and 65. All right, Allegra has 65 points. Brian has... 18 points.
Mm-hmm.
Jonathan has 8 points.
Mm-hmm.
And bringing up the posterior is little Pee-wee with 6 points.
In my 6-finger hand.
That's right. Hey,
just don't peter out, Peter.
Okay.
Allegra, rolling for initiative. Allegra rolls a 7. Mm-hmm. Ryan with a 4. Jonathan with a 5. And Pee-wee criticals with a 10.
So I can give my crappy answer first.
That is correct. All right, and there we go.
Get the garbage
while
out of the way.
I write your guys' names down. Pete, why don't you read that for me?
Name an epic movie character death.
And let me tell you though, there are so many answers that were given, and I had to pick. I had to pick the top 7, and it was so hard because there were so many 2 and 3.
Mike, I have to ask the question. When did you compile this list?
Last year at Balticon.
Yes.
Thank goodness we can ignore a certain movie that came out this year, came out this fall.
Which movie?
Short person movie?
The Herbert.
Hey. Oh.
The Herbert.
The Herbert. The Herbert.
All right, so we
I
got.
Didn't die.
Was it before? Was it before The Hobbit?
Yes.
It was before the last Hobbit movie came out. Yes. Good. Yes.
Question: does TV shows certain... count?
All right, so name an John. Epic movie character death. Death.
And Allegra. No, who goes last? Brian goes last.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Oh, we have a. So when you say movie, you're talking. You know, Mike, when you say movie, you mean in the theater movie, not on VHS.
Yeah, well,
if it was in the theaters.
If it was at some point in a theater, yes.
Okay. But not anything from Asylum then, okay.
What if it was a TV show and it's shown in a movie theater at some point?
You're getting a little too in-depth. Think more broad. Believe me, I was a little disappointed with this, but we're going to have fun with this. Don't you worry.
All right, I'm ready. I'm ready for my first one.
All righty, Peter.
I'm going Darth Vader.
And Allegra.
Boromir.
Jonathan.
Let's see. Emperor Palpatine.
And Brian.
Yep.
For first choice, I'm going to say Mace Windu.
What's going on? Wow, a lot of Star
And I'm
Wars.
Going to just give you guys a hint. This can go outside of the sci-fi fantasy genre. It can and does. Just thought I'd throw that out there. Peter.
They make movies outside sci-fi?
Character movie death. Oh, God, who dies really epically? Oh, shit, I can't think. I'm going to say the Terminator from T2.
Okay, and Allegra.
Looking around for inspiration.
The 27 Ronin. No. Does that count as 27 of them?
And 4, 3, 2, 1.
Oh, God. Does the guy who plays Scarface, does he live through his movie or does he die? He seems like he dies.
Scarface. Just say Scarface.
Scarface.
Yeah, that guy.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Excellent choice, madam. Jonathan.
Oh. Now my brain just went ding, 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 and all of a sudden, plonk. All those years of watching old movies. That's a good one. If I'm guessing outside sci-fi genre.
No.
I'll go with Butch and Sundance. Even though we don't see them die, it's assumed.
All right. And Mr. Brian.
I'm going to go with Sonny Corleone in The Godfather, Death at the Toll Booth.
there!
Run down
the son of a bitch!
Nice. Excellent choice. All right.
Wait, can I guess one more that gets no points? But I feel awful bad if I don't guess this.
You know what? You will get 1 point if it makes it on the list. What is it?
Wash.
Oh, yeah.
From Firefly.
Firefly, yeah.
All right.
I will laugh so hard if the one I have written down is on this list.
How about Brad Pitt from Fight Club?
All right. So here we go. This is going to be very interesting. I'm loving it. Name an epic movie character death, the number one answer. And for all the marbles, or at least most of the marbles, Terminator 2.
Oh! Yes.
Nice.
Yay, I got a number one. With my number two.
Yes.
I'm really good at coming up from behind.
That's my buddy. All right, the number two answer for an epic movie character death. Ripley in Alien 3.
I'm disappointed.
Damn it! I
know.
That. Even though that movie was so bad, that was an awesome terrible. Death.
It was an epic death, though, wasn't it?
I watched most of that movie from my brain.
Falls into a forge of molten lead.
I still say, what's it? Hudson went out better. You want some? You want some? Get some!
Well, I like the ultimate cut where she actually is holding the alien queen embryo in her fist as she falls into the molten lead.
Oh, it's so horrible. It's so horrible.
All right. Number three. Spock in Star Trek 2.
Oh, Lord Almighty.
I know, right?
Spock!
And number four. RoboCop, the toxic waste dude, to me.
Melted Man, yes.
I know. To me, that was should have been higher on the
list. I was thinking RoboCop, but there were so many.
I know.
Like, dude, they get shot up by Ed when Ed kills that guy in the demo. Just turns into Swiss cheese.
All right. Oh. And number five, Kirk in Generations, which...
That was so lame.
Really? I'm falling down the scaffold.
Such a lame death. That was not epic.
I don't know. My heart sunk a little, but all right.
Sci-fi
whatever.
Losers, whatever.
Right, at least they didn't say Kirk in the second reboot movie.
Yeah.
All right. So here we go. The number six epic mover carrier is Wash in Serenity.
Wash.
Ha! 1 point.
Right. In your face.
One point. Oh, I should have made that earlier.
I personally, like, during that time, I was watching Serenity, so, like, that was, like, top of my list. I am a leaf on the wind.
Oh.
All right. And number seven, most epic character death, Hans Gruber in Die Hard.
Oh, that's a good death.
Yeah. I don't know. You guys said
that's actually ones. Sad that... Die Hard was the only, like, non-sci-fi thing on the
list. Yeah, I feel like we were... Yeah. 90% of this is sci-fi. Non-sci-fi.
Mike did not say they were all non-sci-fi. He said you could...
I just tried to get you thinking outside of the box.
Why? Yeah. There's no need.
I should have stuck with friggin' RoboCop.
All right, so what do we have here? We have 16, so 12, 22... And
my inner movie buff is disgusted with this 18. List. I'm like, Godfather's number two on the AFI list, people. Get cultured and watch it for once.
All right, so there was no tiebreaker. So I will save that tiebreaker round.
End. Or exit.
Ooh. Destroy.
And stop presenting, and I come back here, and in first place, yawning and taking a victory stretch, Allegra, with 66 points.
Yay! Good job.
Glorious victory, I tasted it last.
Second place, number two place, was a pincher. It was pinched between Brian and Pete. But Pete was able to pinch ahead for number two.
What? With that one answer?
Oh, wait a minute.
It was
yeah, 22 to 18. Two answers.
Okay.
It was 22 to 18.
Yeah, 22.
Right. Just beat me by three.
And Brian with number three position at 18 points, and John, wah, 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 8 points. That's the way the survey says.
Sweet. Good game. Excellent. Congratulations. The second time that we got beat at this game by a girl. Now, and Jen, I mean, and you both, you and Jen Page both mopped the floor up with us. You didn't just win. You fucking soundly defeated us.
I'm just an example that she set last time.
God.
You'll have to get in touch with Jen and let her know that you you wiped the floor.
I will. I carried on the legacy.
That's funny.
Yeah.
We should play this the next time we have a female guest.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That'd be great. we'll do that. No.
We'll do.
All right. So Brian, let's get on with the news.
All righty. So it looks like Fox is coming up with some interesting plans. Two things are on their maybe list right now. One of them being, with the success of bringing back 24 for that limited series special, they're actually considering bringing back Mulder and Scully for a limited series. X-Files might be coming back for a limited time. They're still talking about it, but because of how well 24 did, John's happy. So we might see Mulder and Scully. I'm excited for it if that goes through. Mm-hmm. And speaking of television, obviously because there are only one of two properties that Fox owns is actually good, and that's X-Men. They are contemplating doing a live-action X-Men TV series.
That is
something they're talking about right now. Earlier today, actually, the chairman, Gary Newman, was actually talking about the potential of making it into a TV series. Huh. So that might be interesting, since we're already getting so many Marvel properties as TV shows now. I mean,
right.
Mm-hmm. We got the Daredevil show coming now, and then Jessica Jones, Luke Cage. And speaking of Jessica Jones, our favorite doctor, David Tennant, is actually going to be playing the main villain in the Jessica Jones TV show.
That's cool.
So that's going to be interesting. So our favorite doctor is going to be the most hated villain on TV. Yay.
That's now, awesome.
I don't want to take away from... I don't want to divert us too much into this, but in the spirit of what I've been geeking on, which we didn't really go over, but I've been kind of binging on the Arrow series on the CW. It was on the CW mm-hmm. network. And
yes.
It's been I finished the first season, and since I've been homesick, I've been binging on the second season now. I'm like six episodes in, and it's keeping my attention. But I, you know, it's one of those things where I don't know. Has anyone else here on the panel or watched?
It's on my list.
Okay,
it's on my list.
Really. I will tell you, like, the fact that it was on CW and it wasn't maybe sponsored by a better network, and, you know, maybe on a better cable channel, right. That what?
No, like AMC or something. I know what you're saying. I got you.
Yeah. It's a country western channel, boy. No, what do you expect?
Wait a minute. I love Smallville, and that was a CW.
Well, no.
CW is super hit and miss with its shows, though. Like, sometimes they come up with good stuff, and then, like, most of the time they come up with something and then just drive into the dirt with, shitty writing, shitty characterization.
My biggest criticism is they didn't have to go, like, 23 episodes per season. They could have kept it tighter and more...
I gotcha.
It's a bit bloated.
Loaded. But to be honest with you, I am attracted to the characters. They're keeping my attention, and I, you know, like the second season, I want to know what happens. And the transition into the second season after the first two episodes kind of it grabbed me. You know, the transition from the big first season, you know, arc to the second season arc. It's grabbed me. So I just wanted to say that based on what you were saying. I know you said Marvel on TV, but it's a DC product.
DC does better TV.
Yes, that's actually the general consensus most masses agree with. Marvel makes better movies, DC makes better television.
And that was part of what I want to say. Like, I'm really kind of curious. Like, you know, did they say anything about possibilities of who would be starring in this, or they haven't even gotten that far?
They're literally playing with it right now. They want to see how a budget would play out, a releasing schedule, pre-production, post-production, all that stuff. There's a lot of planning for this because, you know, obviously, thanks to Days of Future Past and the upcoming Apocalypse movie, X-Men has never been more popular since, like, the cartoon.
That could cause some issues with splintering. Suppose part of the audience gets so attracted to the TV characters that then they're less attracted to the movie characters now, you know, and their actors.
Yeah.
So that could be weird, too. I could see them maybe waiting. But...
Yeah. So back, kind of going back on the hero train, a lot of hero news this week. So some of the casting was released for Civil War for Captain America 3, and it looks like fans of the arch-villain range for Captain America are going to be happy. Baron Zemo. We're going to have Baron Zemo in that movie because Daniel Brühl has been cast as Baron Zemo, and based on the timeline, it looks like it's the second iteration, the second generation. So Baron Zemo was a very interesting villain. You know, he was on par with Red Skull. You know, so that could be interesting. I mean,
I like Baron Zemo. I think Baron Zemo is cool.
Baron Zemo will be interesting. Some people are already asking, are they gonna have him with the Snow Leopard cuffs? You know, the Snow Leopard film cuffs he has on his costume. people want that for some reason. Furs murder people unless it's for food or warmth.
So, any chance a certain web slinger might show up?
Actually, supposedly the deal is just about done. There's been speculation that Sony is going to give Spider-Man to Marvel for Avengers 3 Part 1 and Part 2.
That would be glorious.
Supposedly.
Yeah, that would be glorious.
That is the general consensus right now. There are some people saying it's already happened, and it is. Some people are denying it. This thing is still up in the air. Until Kevin Feige says so... Just fingers crossed and pray, boys and gals.
I hope fingers. So.
Unfortunately, though, Andrew Garfield will not be playing Peter Parker.
And we talked about that. We talked about why, because, you know, he snubbed his Japanese overlords.
Right.
But, god damn, I like Andrew Garfield. He was such a good Peter Parker.
He's good. And, again, on the Marvel train, it looks like our Lord and Savior Joss Whedon will not be directing Avengers 3 and 4. He says it is very doubtful that he's going to be directing those. He will be in charge of the writing and part of the creative team, but he's not going to be directing it.
Right.
Okay. He was recently asked why, and basically here's the quote he said. I couldn't imagine doing this again. It's enormously hard, and it will be. By the time I would make Avengers 3 and 4, a good 5 years since I created anything was completely my own, so it's very doubtful that I would take the two-part Infinity War movie that would eat up the next 4 years of my life. I obviously still want to be part of the Marvel Universe. I love these guys, but it ain't easy. This year's been more like running three shows than any year of my life, and it is bonkers. So it sounds like Whedon's being a little bit stretched thin, so he kind of wants to take a break. I mean, I don't blame him.
He's creative, and he's playing in somebody else's sandbox, which I know he loves and everything, but he doesn't have total creative freedom. He's not creating his own thing, which
I get
that.
And that's what he wants, and I completely understand. But I still have faith in that. I mean, despite people being bummed, because, you know, he did Avengers 1, he's doing this current Avengers 1, it's going to be a bit different. I haven't been able to find exactly who they're going to pick for the directing position. I'm pretty sure it's already out there because this is a slightly old article.
Right.
So we'll probably get corrected. But speaking of interesting production news, for Star Trek 3.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait a minute, Brian. Oh. Did you hear that? John said, hopefully not Michael Bay.
Oh, Disney, I sincerely believe Disney has a band poster with his face on it. Keep this guy out of our office.
Right. He's got a restraining order.
I'm going to kind of turn the bus a little bit to another beloved property, Star Trek 3. It looks like that one of the writers has actually dropped out for Star Trek 3, but a new one stepped up to the plate, and it's our lovely British pal, Simon Pegg.
Yay!
He's going to be co-writing the screenplay for Star Trek 3. I mean, he's a good writer. He co-wrote Spaced and a lot of the Cornetto trilogy stuff he wrote with Edgar Wright. I have faith in Simon Pegg.
Yeah, he'd be good.
So what show are they gonna reimagine now? They did Space Seed in the movie.
Well, they haven't really said. I mean, it was just announced because Orsi dropped. He stepped down as the writer. Mm-hmm. But Simon Pegg just recently, literally within the last couple of days, said, I'll co-write the screenplay.
Well, John, from my understanding, from what I've read, and of course it's, you know, it's anybody's game here, but from what I read, their initial goal was to start the 5-year journey. So it wasn't going to be a playoff of any other movies or anything. It was actually going to be their first encounter. Yeah. Now let's hope they don't decide to go with the menagerie and say, well, that was kind of like their first adventure. It's like, oh God, no, not that one.
Where no man went before.
Which one was that?
The second pilot. They go to the edge of the galaxy and they get psychic powers.
Oh, is that the one with the
Gary
guy...
Mitchell?
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He takes control of the whole ship
It's
like a young guy, right?
Yeah, I think he was the actor who played not Bowman, but the other astronaut in 2001, was it? No, I'm thinking a different person.
I don't know. Hey, if they're going to recreate any other show, let me just put that out there. Star Trek, if you're ever going to create another the original series recreation, do the one with the Treskadalians, you know, 40 quat loots on the winner. It's 50 quat loots on the winner.
Oh yeah,
60 quat loots that they won't finish the match.
Okay, Simon Pegg is a kind of a person where I would imagine he might actually decide to do something like the City of the Edge of Forever. Mm. Of course, that would make Harry Nelson would then have a heart attack and die at that point. he did.
Yeah.
I would doubt he would do it because Harlan would probably sue them if he tried.
Now, I just hope they do something new. Let's hope they do something brand new.
Yeah.
Well, how about the Viger one? You know, with the
die.
Viger.
Stick that microphone in your mouth and electrocute yourself.
Well, with that pleasant mental image in mind, I have to hop off. But okay. It was good talking to you guys.
All right. Spanking
you all at that game.
Oh, didn't mean to get you
all. And we enjoyed being spanked.
Thanks for spanking us.
Thanks
for spanking.
You guys have a good night.
See ya. Surprise. Speaking of the next article, the Crow reboot is under some heavy fire because Luke Evans has officially dropped out of the project. So Luke Evans is not going to be playing our main hero in the Crow reboot. So they've already lost a director, but they got a new one. And now the lead role has dropped out, and now they need to find another one.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Oh, so...
I think this... The comic creator said, "You have my blessings," which is his special way of saying good fucking luck.
Right.
I'm sorry. I honestly believe this is the cosmic forces saying no.
Right.
No, there are some things that are just not meant to be rebooted, especially with something so tragic happening in the original movie.
Could be.
I don't know.
Plus, I don't think there's going to be any room for any reboots once Mad Max comes out.
Oh, God.
It's like right after Avengers.
Yeah.
Because Avengers is May 1st.
You might as well just call it Mad Geesh.
technically, it's a sequel.
I know.
To the other Mad Max.
I know.
And it's like, isn't it like 1.5 or 2.5? It's in between one of the movies. It's like Road Warrior and Thunderdome.
I think it's between Road Warrior and Thunderdome. That's what it was.
Thunderdome.
The only other movie that would be the biggest, like, does anyone know the biggest geesh that Pete would have when they do the reboot of this particular movie? Does anybody guess? Uh-huh. Can anybody guess?
I can guess.
What reboot would make Pete geesh? No, Pete, let me do this.
Okay.
Can anyone guess? Brian? John? Mm. You know Pete. Come on.
And Brian, you know. Mm. Come on. Come on. Come on.
Go ahead. Tell us.
I
Flash. No,
that's
right.
Flash.
They'll dick it up.
Stand by my hook, man.
No,
dive.
No, they'll fuck it up, man.
No. You have to do a proper Brian Blessed, you know.
So I had this idea. Like, if I were to reboot it, of course I've thought of it. Tell me if I'm crazy, but I think The Rock would be an awesome Flash Gordon. I love The Rock. No, I think he's underused.
Oh, Lord, I'm so excited for him playing Black Adam. Oh, you just reminded me that he's playing Black Adam. And
that's right.
Again.
So what are you saying, John?
He'd be better off. I think The Rock would be better as the Hawkman King.
Well, no. If you're gonna make him one of the princes, make him the don't use the Hawkman. Or if you use the Hawkman, that's fine. But
You have to use the Hawkman. It's Flash Gordon.
That's fine. You can use the Lion Men that they didn't use in the 80s movie and make him the Prince of the Lion Men.
There you go.
That'd be a better choice.
And not Scorpions.
So who do you think? No, not Scorpions. Who do you think can make a good Flash Gordon then? I mean,
a good Flash Gordon?
Maybe Mark Wahlberg?
Actually, let's look at this. The first Flash Gordon, what's his name again? The original Flash Gordon. Not Weissmuller. I can't remember his name now. My bad memory.
Anyways,
he was an Olympic star.
Okay.
He was an actor. Buster Crabbe. It was Buster Crabbe. Right. He really wasn't an actor. The second one wasn't much of an actor. The one in the movie we all liked, the campy one, wasn't much of an actor either. Sam Jones. What you want is somebody who's going to be the straight man for everybody.
Okay.
You need somebody. And unfortunately, that almost means someone we don't know right now because we haven't found him yet.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know.
I apologize. I'm grabbing the train.
Okay, sorry, Brian.
I'm sorry, Brian. I did not mean for this to happen. Take it.
You're back in the engine. Go ahead. Drive away.
So I found out something interesting from our buddies at geekology.com. Anyone remember the Double Down? KFC's wonderful heart-destroying concoction.
I've seen this. They just came out
with a new one. So far, it's only been shown in Korea and in the Philippines, but there's a good chance you might see it here in the States.
Oh, please.
Hold on, Mike. I'm a screen share. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. The Double Down Dog.
Yeah.
It is a Double Down chicken patty as buns with a hot dog and mustard. Yeah.
Nice. I want one.
Mystery meat wrapped in mystery meat.
I want one, but I honestly was expecting something a little better.
No, I would eat that.
You know what?
But I'll try. You
know what the whole purpose of the Double Down is to replace the bread with meat.
Yes.
Yes.
So,
John, you are getting ready to say bacon, right?
No. Gravy.
Oh, okay. Gravy. Oh, gravy. Gravy would be good. You get like, you know what?
I was going to say, instead of mustard, actually gravy.
Like a tub of it, like a little container of it that you could dip it into.
Like an
au jus. Yeah. Either that or a nice cup of melted cheese, that stuff that's not really cheese, it's like yellow and they call it cheese.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's whipped cheese.
You put cheese in there and then you dip in the gravy.
Oh, yeah, it's like protein.
Cheese.
Only in America, folks. Only in America.
But all right. Good, fine.
I got one last thing. It's not really much of a news thing, but it's something I like to call the Kickstarter Spotlight.
Okay.
It's a project I found that I sincerely believe we all should take a part in funding because it already made its goal, but Jesus Christ, why isn't this in game stores? So a company called Monolith Board Games LLC is working on a 2-to-5-player Conan the Barbarian board game.
Oh, I've seen this thing. It looks awesome.
Huh. And you can play as Conan and other various characters, even Valeria. Character sheets, miniatures and all. I've seen this. It is amazing. Wow. It has it. They only need. Here's the funny thing. They only needed $80,000 for this thing. It has 15 days left on the clock. Guess how much money they've raised so far?
$1 million.
$1.241 million.
Yeah. Oh.
John might be cheating.
a gigaflop million.
Dear Lord, people, this thing should have been in game stores long ago. So, yeah. Lord knows I love me some sword and sorcery.
As Kickstarters go, just because I pay attention to a lot of Kickstarters, being that I had one, because it made $1 million, everybody who's pledged into it, it's going to be later than shit. Because now the guy's got to make a zillion fucking copies of this thing. It's going to take
forever.
What's
really funny, though, is they're actually running out of incentives, like stretch goals. They don't know what to do. I'm literally on the Kickstarting page. It hasn't changed in like a week. It's like, we can't come up with anything else. Stop giving us money.
Right.
Well, stop buying this.
Well, I mean,
if you're gonna tell that one, because it sounds like a great one, I may actually invest in it. I'm gonna tell one that I invested in that has broke $4 million.
Holy fuck! $4 million. Which one is that?
Exploding Kittens, a card
game.
Oh,
I've seen that. Exploding Kittens.
$4 million.
All over the internet just to blow up some kittens. Lord,
you get two decks
mercy.
Now. You get the safe for work deck, and you get the not safe for work deck.
Christ.
But, you know what it is?
Internet and kitten. That they were like, oh, well, hey, we're gonna put it on the internet. Let's put cats in it.
The artist is the artist for Oatmeal.
Oh, okay. So he's got a big popularity. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. That explains a lot. Right. I mean, but the main thing is back to the Conan game. I mean, I'm looking at this. They've made additional heroes based on the Robert E. Howard stories. They've made, now they have a book campaign / art book in there. I mean, they're really stretching this. They're like, we're trying to give you more stuff since you're giving us all this money, but, you know, let's see. Their current stretch goal, which is at the 1.2 million mark, is the equipment pack. It's basically in the game, equipment is done in card form. It's sort of like Talisman. Basically character sheets, cards. It plays like Talisman, but with actual miniatures. I'm talking like straight up miniatures, not a cone or a little symbol like Monopoly. I mean, and I dig it. I'm probably gonna pitch in for this because Lord have mercy, I love me some Conan the Barbarian.
But dude, you know what I would say to them, if I could talk to them at this moment, I would tell them, don't do any more stretch goals. You've made your money. I don't think they are.
Don't
fuck with the product, because now you're trying to squeeze in all this other stuff.
Well, the thing is, all these stretch goals are just stuff I'm imagining that was going to come out later as expansion stuff, like these extra heroes, these miniatures. Right. I mean, one of the stretch goals for hitting $1 million is a free poster of the Hyborian continent in color.
Nice.
Which is nice. You know, and they also have monsters like giant scorpions. They have, let me see, some of the monsters they have is giant scorpions, obviously the giant snake, the swamp demon, giant spiders. I mean, they even have, like, you can just get tentacles, like tentacle miniatures. For when you fight leviathans or krakens. I mean, you know, I'm excited for this. I'm probably gonna, if I can't get it within the next 15 days, I'm definitely gonna pick it up when it hits store shelves. Cause,
they've already hit that stretch goal you talked about, because they made $1.24 million. Wait a second, we gotta do it right. $1 million.
So is this like the Robotech Kickstarter where the numbers are just ticking up every time you hit refresh? The number's bigger and bigger.
Yeah. Well, you don't even have to refresh. I've been watching it while we started this show. It's been ticking. It went up like $1,000 since we started.
Oh gosh,
Jesus.
I was just
Hey, you know what? My Kickstarter didn't do that.
Yeah, it was just more like on a daily basis or a weekly basis.
Well, yeah. It's also a matter of luck. It's also because it's coming in the fucking barbarian.
Yeah, absolutely.
We need good Conan products.
Right.
I mean, we have the movies.
Whenever you put figures in something, if the figures look half decent, that's the figures actually look decent.
If you go to Kickstarter.com and type in Conan or Monolith Board Games, it'll come up, and the miniatures actually look good. They're like Reaper miniatures. They're that kind of quality. Nice.
And there's licensing fees involved with that too that they have to pay out. There's a lot of money.
Sure.
The Howard family owns this sort of lock, stock, and barrel.
They won't get to keep all that.
Disney found out.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, but Brian, you got anything
that
else?
That was my Kickstarter spotlight. Hopefully, awesome. I'll find some more interesting stuff for next week.
Cool. Mm-hmm. All right. Are we done?
Yeah. Looks like we're done.
Okay. Excellent. All right. So,
well, the only closing word I can say is, of course, if you're going to do a Flash Gordon movie or TV series, do not make Ming the Merciless a middle manager.
Oh, Christ, that TV show was a fucking train wreck and a half. That thing was ridiculous. Hey, John, you know what? John, it never happened. Yeah. Never happened.
Yeah.
Never happened.
Nope. Never happened.
Never happened.
The Saturday morning cartoon when we were kids was better. Far better.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, everybody. Let's wrap this show up. All right, John, thanks for coming on, and thanks for talking to us about all the Tri Tac stuff. Make sure to check out the links. We'll put them in the show notes. You know, go buy Tri Tac stuff. It's really awesome. It's good stuff. And make sure to buy everything, because Richard can use the money. He really can.
Yeah.
All right, everybody. Be quiet while I run
number
the
one rule. Oh, well.
You've just enjoyed the MythWits. Join us for a live broadcast next week and every week. Mondays at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We have a chat room that you can ask any question of our guests. If you miss our live show, you can always catch the encore episodes and the podcast version at our website and on iTunes. We hope you had a blast. Make sure to check out our website at mythwits.com. And, of course, visit us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and iTunes. Do the like, follow, subscribe thing wherever it's appropriate. And please give us a review on iTunes. It's way more important than you think. MythWits is a Studio187.com production and is protected under an attribution, non-commercial, no derivatives, Creative Commons work. You can download and share it with whoever you like. Just don't change it and don't try to make money with it. Make sure to check out Studio187.com for more cool stuff. See you all next week.